Good morning. Let us join our hearts in preparation for worship. Let us have a seat, and there will be words up on the screen for this next song, Forever. As we sing, this helps us prepare our hearts and our minds to join into worship. God and King, His love endures forever. For He is good, He is above all things. His love endures forever. Sing praise, sing praise, sing praise, sing praise. What a mighty hand and an outstretched arm. His love endures forever. For the life that's in me born, His love endures forever. Sing praise, sing praise, sing praise, sing praise. Forever God is faithful, forever God is strong. Forever God is with us, forever and ever. Forever God is faithful, forever God is strong. Forever God is with us, forever and ever. From the rising to the setting sun, His love endures forever. And by the grace of God, He will carry on. His love endures forever. Sing praise, sing praise, sing praise, sing praise. Forever God is faithful, forever God is strong. Forever God is with us, forever and ever.
Well, good morning. Welcome to the service of worship. We'll go through a few announcements as we do. I invite you to sign the friendship pads. They should be in front of you somewhere near the center of the aisle. Today, the youth group and Presby Kids Club, we are going tubing a bogus basin. That's going to be a lot of fun. There will be a congregational meeting after the worship service today, and that's our annual congregational meeting. Important. We do a few things. We elect new officers, leaders of the church, elders and deacons both. We also review the budget, and you also approve the pastor's salary and compensation in terms of call. Then I want you to know the 2016 year-end giving statements, they're available on the back table. At the back of the church, Sandy's holding one up. Then you are invited to celebrate Kathy Madsen's 80th birthday. There's going to be an open house here at church hosted by her family, and the date for that is Saturday, January 28th from 1 to 5 p.m. You're all invited. And then lastly, I just let you know, after the worship service and before the congregational meeting, you'll have a chance to be anointed. This is a Sunday where traditionally this church has recommitted itself to God, and so you'll be invited, if you choose, to come forward and receive an anointing of oil to symbolize your commitment to God and to the church. So I invite you to do that. Now, why don't we stand and greet each other with a friendly welcome.
Good morning. Has everybody found their seat again? Please stand for the call to worship. May the Lord answer you when you are in distress. May the name of God of Jacob protect you. May we shout for joy over your victory and lift up our banners in the name of our God.
Let us remain standing and continue in worship as we sing, "Come, ye sinners, poor and needy," and then softly and tenderly, "Jesus is calling."
Come ye weary
not conscience make you linger, nor of fitness fondly dream. All the fitness ye requireth is to feel your need of him. I will arise and go to Jesus. He will embrace me in his arms, in the arms of my dear Savior. Oh, there are 10,000 charms.
Seated while we do the prayer of confession.
Okay.
We meet you here in worship. We experience your love. We hear you calling us, but we are paralyzed by sin and weighted down by guilt. Hear our confession and set us free to follow you. We have heard the call. We want to be your disciples, but we do not want to take up a cross. Those who have given up their lives for their faith inspire us. We hope we will be able to do the same. Yet we struggle to make small sacrifices. We hold back from giving up an evening for Bible study, from volunteering, from the relatively small commitments of church participation. How then can we imagine that we could make a bigger sacrifice? We confess that we are stubborn, selfish, and hard of heart. Forgive us and help us to follow you. Hear the good news. Who is in a position to condemn? Only Christ, and Christ died for us. Christ rose for us. Christ reigns in power for us. Christ prays for us. Anyone who is in Christ is a new creation. The old life has gone. A new life has begun. Know that you are forgiven and be at peace. Amen.
Please be seated. We'll do the children's message now. I'd like to have the children come forward. Hi, Justine. Well, hi, everybody. It's good to see you. I wanted to ask you something this morning. It's an important question I want to ask you to think about. How do you know about God? How did you learn about God?
I don't know.
Yeah, how did you learn about God, Colton? The Bible? That's good. Yeah, the Bible is really, that's the very original source of how we learned about God. How else do we learn about God? Do you read the Bible? Do you read the Bible on your own? Has anyone else ever read the Bible to you? Sometimes. Who might read the Bible to you? Mom or dad might read the Bible to you, yeah. Mom and dads are good at reading the Bible, and they're good at helping us understand what it means. Who else can you think of that helps you know and learn about God?
I want to think about the dinosaurs. Because they're my favorite. All the dinosaurs are my favorite.
Dinosaurs are awesome. They are very awesome. And you probably read books about those, and maybe your mom and dad teach you about dinosaurs too, huh? Yeah. Yeah.
Like if there's any dinosaurs around here, we gotta figure out where they belong.
Yeah, that's true. Very true. Well, what I want to end with is to say, isn't it nice that we don't have to learn about God all on our own? We don't have to figure it all out by ourselves. We don't have to make up what God is like out of our own minds, but we have people around us that teach us about God and a tradition that tells us about God. It's not just up to us, and that is a very good thing, because if it were up to us, we probably wouldn't know as much about God as we do. So let's say a prayer and thank God for that. God, thank you that you've given us a tradition going all the way back to the Bible, but all the faithful people between now and the time of the Bible, they help us to understand who you are. We thank you that we have that guidance from our parents and our community and our faith tradition. And we thank you and we pray these things in Jesus' name, and all God's children said, amen. Amen. All right, thanks everybody. We'll come together in a time of prayer, bow our heads, invite you to join me, and we won't use the Lord's Prayer at the end of this. We will save that for the end of communion. So let's pray. Gracious and loving God, thank you for the day. Thank you that even though we may not like the weather. It's a sign to us that you bring rain and snow on the just and the unjust. You're gracious, whether we deserve it or not. And in that, Lord, in just looking outside, we see an image of grace, and we don't understand it. It defies logic. It defies human understanding. But you are all about grace, and that is a blessing to us, even when we don't realize it. Lord, thank you for the chance to worship you. Thank you for these children. We pray that you would give our church a spirit of commitment, both to you and to the tradition that we've inherited, that we are not here in this church creating things up on our own, but we've received from you and through our community and through those who have come before us a tradition of wisdom and knowledge and faith. Help us to be faithful and committed to preserving that and continuing it, and even, Lord, to grow it. We pray now on behalf of those who are in need, those who have prayers that they haven't mentioned, fears and concerns that keep them awake at night. We lift them up and ask that you'd bless them, be with them, give them guidance, and especially peace. We pray for Bertha Mullins, whose granddaughter Annie was diagnosed with cancer. We pray both for Bertha and for Annie that your healing touch would be upon her and that your promises would be apparent. We give praise, Lord, for Betty Pearson, who's 93 years young today. Thank you for her witness and her faith. Lord, we love you, and we give all the glory for the good things to you. And Lord, we bring our suffering and our problems and our questions and lay those at your feet as well. And we do it all in the name of Jesus Christ. Amen.
Let us remain prayerfully seated as we sing, "We Are an Offering."
Our voices, we lift our hands.
Well, today is commitment, or maybe we should say recommitment Sunday, and I'm actually curious. I should know this maybe, but Sean, how long has this church done a commitment Sunday like this during the early weeks of the new year?
Ever since I've been here, which is a long time. 11 years, so I know they were doing it before then, too.
Wow, okay. So for over 11 years, at least 11 years, this church has done, at the beginning of the year, a commitment Sunday where the church members are asked, or given the opportunity, I should say, to commit or recommit to God and to the church. And so I picked a scripture from the Old Testament, which is a little bit like a recommitment service. This was right after the time of the Exodus. Moses has died, and the people of Israel are not yet the people of Israel. They're the Hebrew people. They've fled from Egypt, and they stand now at the precipice, at the very border of Israel, the land that God has promised them. And as they stand on the border, they look out. Their new leader, Joshua, asks them a question: will you commit to God? And this, though they followed Moses, though they've seen the miracles, here they have the opportunity to recommit themselves to the God that's brought them out of Egypt and is giving them this new land. So let's listen to the word of the Lord. Now therefore, fear the Lord and serve him in sincerity and in faithfulness. Put away the gods that your fathers served beyond the river and in Egypt, and serve the Lord. And if it is evil in your eyes to serve the Lord, choose this day whom you will serve, whether the gods your fathers served in the region beyond the river, or the gods of the Amorites in whose land you dwell. But as for me and my house, we will serve the Lord. Then the people answered, far be it from us that we should forsake the Lord to serve other gods. For it is the Lord our God who brought us and our fathers up from the land of Egypt, out of the house of slavery, and who did these great signs in our sight and preserved us in all the way that we went and among all the peoples through whom we passed. And the Lord drove out before us all the peoples, the Amorites who lived in the land. Therefore, we also will serve the Lord, for he is our God. But Joshua said to the people, you are not able to serve the Lord, for he is a holy God. He is a jealous God. He will not forgive your transgressions or your sins. If you forsake the Lord and serve foreign gods, then he will turn and do you harm and consume you after having done you good. And the people said to Joshua, no, but we will serve the Lord. Then Joshua said to the people, you are witnesses against yourselves that you have chosen the Lord to serve him. And they said, we are witnesses. He said, then put away the foreign gods that are among you and incline your heart to the Lord, the God of Israel. And the people said to Joshua, the Lord our God we will serve, and his voice we will obey. And so Joshua made a covenant with the people that day, and put in place statutes and rules for them at Shechem. And Joshua wrote these words in the book of the law of God. And he took a large stone and set it up there under the terebinth that was by the sanctuary of the Lord. And Joshua said to all the people, behold, this stone shall be a witness against you, for it has heard all the words of the Lord that he spoke to us. Therefore it shall be a witness against you, lest you deal falsely with your God. And so Joshua sent the people away, every man to his inheritance. This is the word of the Lord. So Joshua's not a very good salesman here. No, it's almost like he's trying to discourage the people from committing to God, rather than what we would expect, sort of a sermon that was encouraging them to commit and put their trust in God. He leads with the downside. He leads with the liabilities of following God. It's almost like he's saying, look, choose this day who you'll serve. But let me just tell you, what this God is like. This God is jealous. This God is holy. So if you choose to serve this God, it will be God who holds you accountable. So make your decision wisely. He says that God is a holy God and a jealous God, and that God will not forgive. Now, I usually preach that God is forgiving. But right here in the Bible, where I can't deny it, it says that God won't, that God is jealous. And so what do you make of that? I think the key is in the scripture. It's verse, I believe, 23, when Joshua says, "Therefore put away the foreign gods." See, I think God will forgive any sin. There's nothing that you could possibly do that God won't forgive. But what God won't tolerate is split loyalty. God will forgive anything and everything, but God has to be your only God. Now, that might sound easy. I don't know, on the way to church, you probably didn't pass any pagan temples. And even if you did, you probably weren't very tempted to stop in and lay an offering or worship a foreign god. But what if idols, what if foreign gods aren't just these religious figures? What if idols are values and principles? What if foreign gods or idols are anything that govern our choices? It's that which determines our values and our priorities in life. Now, with a broader definition, it gets a little harder. What God is saying is, God must be the only one, the only Lord, who determines your values, your principles, and your choices, and your priorities. And God is jealous, meaning that God will not tolerate any competitors. You all know that Jesus said you can't serve God and money. But the problem isn't necessarily the money. The problem is the and. The problem is the and. It's not that money is evil. It's you can't serve God and fill in the blank. There is no and. God is a jealous God. And God is the Lord in every area, all your principles, all your values, not just some. God is a jealous God, and he must be your only God. So commit to God, but know that he's jealous. And the next thing I'm going to say is going to be upsetting, maybe, but let me say it simply. To commit to God is to commit to the church. Not necessarily this one. It doesn't have to be this one, although I hope it is. But to commit to God is to commit to the church. And you might ask what I mean by that. You might say, well, why can't I just commit to God as a private individual? And that's a good question, a very good question. And let me respond by another one. What is it that you commit to? What does a person commit to? When they commit to God without a community to give them other points of view, without a tradition of generations and generations of people who've read and studied the scriptures that came before them, without a great cloud of witnesses to inform them about who God is, what does a person really commit to without a church and all that it represents? And I would argue that what a person commits to in that situation is a God of their own creation, a God made of their own ideas and experiences. And this, what else is it but an idol, a God of human creation? Now, if I want to commit to God, I can't do it without the church, without a tradition that goes back thousands of years, something that's bigger than me, something that's broader than just my ideas and my opinions to inform me about who God is. Otherwise, what I worship is an invention out of my own heart. So to commit to God is to commit to the church. Imagine if someone had been standing before Joshua. Imagine one of those Hebrew people who had passed through the desert. Imagine them saying, well, Joshua, I commit to God, but I'm going to just go back to Israel. I'll commit to God on my own, and I'll leave you here in Israel to do your thing. No. No. In Joshua's time, if you wanted to commit to God, you also committed to be one of the people of Israel. And it's the same today. And it doesn't, I'm not saying there's one true church. But if you want to commit to God, commit to a church. And I sure do hope that it's this one. One last point about commitment before we move forward into communion and give you a chance to be anointed. Commitment is a strange virtue, I think. It's one of the only virtues that we tend to overestimate in other people. Normally, we overestimate our own virtues and underestimate other people's. That's kind of the fallen human nature. But with commitment, it's the opposite. We tend to overestimate it in other people. I'll tell you a story, show you what I mean. There was once a king, and a king had a daughter. Beautiful only daughter, and this daughter was to be married. It was a joyful event for all the kingdom, and the king, 3 months before the wedding, sent out invitations to all the people of the kingdom. And the king asked for no presents, no gifts, but instead that each household in the kingdom would take a pitcher of their finest red wine and bring that wine into the town square and pour it into a giant barrel. And then on the day of the wedding, after the ceremony and before the feast, the king could open up the giant keg of wine and have a toast with the shared bounty, the shared goodness of the entire kingdom. And so the invitations went out, and as the weeks went by, the heads of the households would walk into the center of the town where there was a giant wooden barrel. They climbed up the ladder and they poured a pitcher of their best wine into the barrel. And you could see the level rise up until the day of the wedding. And the ceremony was beautiful. The king's daughter was married. The service went well. And then it was time for the feast. And the king went and he tapped the keg, and he turned on the spigot, and he held up to it a clear crystal glass, and out of the keg poured pure water. What had happened is that each person said to themselves, there are so many people in the kingdom. They'll do their part. Surely no one will notice if I just pour a pitcher of water into this keg. But each person did this. Each person assumed that their neighbor would step up and do what was asked. The same thing can happen in churches. The same thing can happen in communities, in all democracies, where we somehow, ironically, assume that other people's commitments will be greater than our own. That we don't have to step up because somebody else will. You're going to have a chance to commit to God and to the church after we take communion. I invite you to take this time of communion to reflect, to examine yourselves if there might be any other gods in our hearts, mine or yours, something that we're serving, something that's ordering our values besides God, and ask God to put it out of our minds and out of our hearts. And then I'll invite you to come forward and be anointed as a symbol of your commitment both to God and to the church. Before we do that, I'd like to invite you to pray with me. Gracious God, we know who you are. You are not the God we made up for ourselves, but you are the God that we inherited from the Scripture, from our parents, from thousands of years of faithful Christians who handed down to us wise and good interpretations of your word. We worship you, the God of Israel, the God of Jacob, the God of Abraham, the God of Jesus, and of Paul and Peter, and all the Christians who've come before us. Lord, we commit to you, and we commit to that tradition and that community. We commit to the very people in this room who we need to show us compassion and love, to forgive us, to show us mercy, to encourage us, and yes, even to correct us and teach us. Lord, we pray that you would put this spirit of commitment in our hearts, that we would serve no other gods but you and make you the only God. There is no and for us. We are yours, and you alone are our Lord. We pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. Let's bring forth our tithes and offerings. Please remain standing and we will recite together the Apostles' Creed. This is